There's a good argument to be made that without Star Trek, maybe you don't get Star Wars, The Matrix, or really any other modern-day mainstream sci-fi franchise. Star Trek laid the foundation for what a lot of those things would become. The road, however, to becoming one of the longest-running, most culturally important, and critically praised cross-media franchises of all time is going to be anything but smooth. In fact, the series creator of Star Trek came dangerously close to not having a show at all. And that's because NBC fired everyone involved with the original Star Trek pilot, except for one guy, Spock.
The circumstances are not normal.
Star Trek's original pilot has become something of an urban legend since its release. The fact that Star Trek is a name brand known around the world is a testament to the creators involved being nimble in knowing which creative battles to fight and which to let the studio or network win. This juncture is one at which most creators fall into an abyss and fail. However, due to some quick thinking and stick-to-itiveness, Star Trek prevailed. But it was a long journey. Star Trek creator Gene Roddenberry had an adventurous life prior to working in show business. He served in the Army during World War II, later becoming a police officer, and eventually made his way into TV working on shows like Have the Will Travel and Bat Masterson.
Masterson's name. Bat Masterson.
This resulted in him being commissioned by NBC to create his own show, The Lieutenants, a show loosely based on his time in the military, which unfortunately would only last a single season. Despite this failure, NBC executives liked him enough and wanted more from him relatively immediately. So what did he do? Pitch an idea in conjunction with Desilu Studios, the studio run by Desi Arnaz and Lucille Ball.
I Love Lucy is a Desilu production.
And it was an idea that would take the best of the military workplace drama from The Lieutenant and pair it with the creative and highly commercial engine of his time working on westerns. His pitch? Well, that would be Star Trek. And on January 22nd, 1965, a pilot would be completed for Star Trek titled The Cage. Written by Roddenberry, directed by Robert Butler, and featuring Leonard Nimoy as an alien named Spock, Jeffrey Hunter as Captain Christopher Pike, the creator of the show's real-life girlfriend as number one, and John Hoyt as Star Trek's own Dr. Phil.
Who wants a warm martini?
The pilot follows Hunter's Pike as he's drawn down to an alien world, falls in love with a human woman, and quickly realizes that he's being held prisoner by an alien race that's physically manipulating him into procreating with a woman for their scientific study.
This is necessary in order to perpetuate the species.
The initial reaction from NBC brass was that the pilot was too cerebral, too slow, and there was not enough action. So with that surface-level criticism levied, what exactly was The Cage? Well, it's something that's fascinating for a few reasons. The episode feels almost like a dress rehearsal version of Star Trek, which, frankly, is what every single pilot ever is. Jeffrey Hunter's Captain Pike is a subdued, stern man. He's directly in contrast to Shatner's eventual scene-chewing Kirk.
We may go up into the biggest ball of fire since the last sun on these parts exploded, but we've got to take that 1 in 10,000 chance!
He's a quiet man who plays the stalwart hero well enough. And by proxy, this impacted the way Leonard Nimoy played Spock. He's much more dramatic in an attempt to play off of that, which, as we all know, is the exact opposite of what Spock would do, as the character's eventual Vulcan backstory was fleshed out and developed by other Star Trek writers.
I took an oath to carry out responsibilities which were clearly and exactly specified.
Another noticeable change from The Cage to the second pilot was that Number One was removed from the show entirely. Roddenberry had initially wanted Number One to play a vital role in the show, in order to examine the internal bias of the men working on the Enterprise. However, NBC execs did not like the woman being so prominently placed in a position of power, so they asked him to remove her from the show. And while some may think what happens next is unprecedented or crazy, it actually happens all the time. And Star Trek wasn't all that special in this way. NBC opted not to move ahead with the show as it was, but instead asked the creators to reconfigure the show and refilm a completely new pilot with a brand new script and brand new cast. This was all largely due to the behind-the-scenes lobbying of Lucille Ball herself, who at this point in time was the head of Desilu. She liked Roddenberry and believed in his vision of what science fiction could be on television, and she also thought the show could be a success if it was given a chance to grow and mature. That time, apparently, was then and now. And in turn, the only survivor of all of this turmoil was Leonard Nimoy's Spock.
We've lost the captain.
Captain Pike was replaced by Shatner's now beloved Captain Kirk, and James Doohan as Scotty, and well, so was basically everyone else. And a brand new pilot, Where No Man Has Gone Before, was written by Samuel L. Peoples and shot. The new pilot, directed by James Goldstone, met NBC's standards, and they gave the show a green light. It was aired on September 22nd, 1966, and centers on the Enterprise's attempt to cross the Great Barrier at the edge of the galaxy. And surprisingly, two of the crew members develop immense psychic abilities and threaten the safety of the ship, which apparently was just enough drama and just enough action. Not just for NBC, the first season of Star Trek ended up being an immediate rating success.
Yep. Hurrah.
In order to meet the rapid production pace of the initial outing, Roddenberry and company opted to recycle the footage from the cage and actually incorporate it into the show, which is once again where this pilot gets a little bit weirder. The 11th and 12th episodes of the first season were dubbed The Menagerie. In the episode, Spock has abducted a former commander named Christopher Pike, commandeers the Enterprise to set course for the planet Talos IV, and then turns himself in for court-martial. This functions as a framing sequence for the rest of the show, which intercuts between Kirk and Bones interviewing Spock and observing footage of what he's describing. But that's not what's interesting. What is interesting is that intercutting is just footage from the cage. Now, as we now know, unfortunately, Star Trek didn't survive as expected. It was canceled after its second season when ratings dipped. However, the largest letter writing campaign in television history was mounted by fans, and the show was brought back for a third season, which went off the rails again when some of the creative team left, and the characters, like Spock, were screwed with, proving that ultimately, Roddenberry made the right call when he went to bat for Nimoy's Spock. And now is a large reason why the show has had longevity, wormed its way into the broader culture, and eventually resurrected as a series of theatrically released feature films. A group of people recognized that Nimoy, that Spock, was special, and that one bit of recognition changed all of their lives forever, and in some ways, that of millions. Now, obviously, casting is an important part of film and television. That's one of the more obvious elements of anything. It's the reason that there's 9 billion news stories every time Tom Holland is cast in something new. It's the same reason that everybody argues constantly about who should be the next Spider-Man, for instance.
Donald for Spider-Man. We're only gonna watch the next Spider-Man if Donald Glover's playing Peter Parker.
Sometimes it's important as creators to push for the people you want on your projects when you want them on those projects. What I think is more interesting and maybe more pertinent here, and maybe even less immediately obvious, is the way in which studios often don't have their hands on the pulse of the bodies they're burying. Way too often, studios pull triggers far too quickly. Sometimes studios are right. Other times, the studios themselves simply don't know what they're looking for. And that's a really important element of creating and of being an artist. It's always worth remembering that just because you show something to everybody doesn't mean everybody knows how to critique that thing or even how to help you make it better. But it is also very important to remember who that criticism is coming from and whether or not that criticism is valuable enough for you to change course or fight for that very thing someone else wants removed. Because sometimes people just have no idea what the hell they're looking at. Well, guys, that's it for today's episode of Nerdstalgic. If you enjoyed this one, press the like button down below. If you haven't yet done so, also hit subscribe. I'm just here right now, two more episodes of Nerdstalgic. You can stay right here. Check those out, and hopefully I'll see you guys in the next video.